Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. We're actually still 1 minute early, but that's what happens when you put a Swiss in charge of an event in Japan. My name is Patrick Zoll. I'm working for the Swiss newspaper Neue Zürcher Zeitung. And we have today three distinguished guests who are going to talk to us about Yasukuni and Japan's crisis in Asia. Let me introduce them quickly. In the middle, we have Togo Sensei. Many of you know him. He's a former diplomat and now a professor at Kyoto Sangyo University. And in a recent Asahi interview, he said, the Yasukuni issue reveals Japan's failure to understand wartime responsibility. Next to me is Dr. Sven Sahler. He's an associate professor of Japanese history at Sophia University, and he has published extensively on Yasukuni. He will show you his newest book, or an article in his newest book. I met him recently. He told me that actually he would like to switch to another research topic. I think he will not manage, is my impression. Our third guest is Chris Winkler. He is a senior research fellow at the German Institute of Japanese Studies. He wrote his doctoral thesis about constitutional reform as a symbol of post-war conservatism. He's also working, or the institute has a program on research on happiness. Maybe we find out what Yasukuni has to do with the happiness of Japanese people. We have, in order, Chris Winkler will go first because he will give us a little bit the background, actually, what is the institutional setting that allowed Prime Minister Abe to go to Yasukuni. Mr. Sahler will go second. He's going to talk to us about the choice Abe had and Abe made, and maybe why he made this choice. And Togo Sensei will then look at the international diplomatic repercussions of that visit, and he has actually a personal proposal what should be done to get out of this mess. Before I forget, please turn them off or silence them so they don't disturb us. What? Oh, we have also Martin Kulling. You know him. Come on. Martin Kulling, vice president of this club here. Chris Winkler, please.
Well, thank you very much for the introduction and the kind invitation. what I'm going to talk to you about today is primarily the implications or the background why Abe visited the shrine, and not so much the repercussions on the international level. I guess Togo Sensei is far more better equipped to talk about this than I am. So why did Abe visit the shrine? Well, the simple answer is because he wanted and because he could. So this sounds very simplistic, and you are certainly not here to hear me say that, because it's obvious. But if we look at Abe's, and this is not only Abe's agenda, but for the most part, a conservative or right-wing agenda in this country that conservatives, people on the right wing, have been pushing for as long as we have the post-war regime, are, well, three main issues. The first being patriotic education, the second being visits to the Yasukuni Shrine, and then last but not least being constitutional reform. Now, if we look at Abe's two terms as prime minister, during his first stint that was cut short by, well, his stomach ulcers and certain defeats in elections, he managed to get the fundamental law on education revised and managed to get the public referendum on the constitutional reform passed by the Diet. Now, he did not manage to go to Yasukuni, as you know, and he has expressed deep regret about that. Now, since 2012, he has, well, pushed the patriotic education issue even further, with the LDP debating whether to drop the mentioning or the consideration for neighboring countries in, well, deliberations on the textbook issue, which is something that probably Professor Sadler will talk about later. He, and that's the reason why we're all here, went to Yasukuni in December. And, well, constitutional reform is, well, still unclear, but there is a very strong chance that, assuming the LDP will come to terms with the Komeito, there will be at least a reinterpretation of Article 9 to allow collective self-defense, maybe within this year, maybe next year. Constitutional reform as such is, from my perspective, rather unlikely at this point. Now, what is the background to this agenda? So, many of you no doubt know Towards a Beautiful Country, Abe's famous, some may say infamous book, Utsukushi Kuni, which he published before he became prime minister in 2006. And in this book, the prime minister has laid out very clearly how he feels about the present state of post-war Japan and how that relates to history issues and to the shrine. Now, for one, Abe has, and he's not alone in that, expressed very strong criticism of the Tokyo Tribunal as, well, victors' justice, that the Allied powers, being victors, simply punished the Japanese harshly, and that was unjust. Now, at the same token, the souls that are enshrined at Yasukuni were not only the emperor's toys, but rather served a greater purpose. And Abe makes this, in the book, talks about the kamikaze pilots devoting their lives to the nation, which is something that, if the times are dire, that people should do. So the entire argument of war centers around the fact that, well, the state is not evil after all. And that is the fabrication of, well, post-war Japan. Instead, the state provides, for instance, social security, and nobody would say, well, that's bad. So there is a very different concept of how we view the state and how we view the state in relation to the people, expressed here, that is fundamentally different from what we would consider, well, standard liberal constitutionalism or, well, Western-style constitutionalism, in which we try to come up with a constitution to govern inevitable conflicts between the governed and those who govern, but rather the concept that Mr. Abe has no doubt borrowed from conservative intellectuals to create, well, a unity between the state and the people. So this conflict should not, there should be no conflict between, well, people and state, but rather unity, a national unity. And in a way, Yasukuni is one embodiment of these ideals. The LDP's constitutional reform draft, for instance, would be another. Now, that is sort of the ideological background. I'm pretty sure Professor Sadler will talk a little bit about that more later. Now, as for why could he go, whereas in 2006 and 2007 he couldn't? Well, for once, diplomatic relations with the PRC, with South Korea, are already chilly, and so it wouldn't get any worse. Of course, and this is probably something that Togo-sensei will explain in more detail, what the Japanese government did not expect was the pretty harsh reaction coming from the other side of the Pacific. Now, another thing, and these are for the most part domestic factors, is that public opinion on the issue is split, if not indifferent, and Abe still benefits from the economics boom. Just to give you a few figures, what you're seeing here is that compared to 2006, fewer people support Abe's visit to the Yasukuni Shrine, but it's still very much even. And this is something that we see in opinion polls throughout the post-war period, that the public is very much split on the issue whether the prime minister should go or should not go. Now, at the same time, cabinet approval ratings have remained fairly high. Abe has been now in power for more than a year, and approval ratings are still above 50%, which is very good if you compare that to Abe's recent LDP predecessors or to the DPJ governments, for instance. So there is very little public pressure, actually, to not to go. Another issue is that within the LDP, there is no opposition anymore. So we once had a very, very strong liberal wing within the LDP, the so-called conservative mainstream, what is known as the Kojikai. That is the old Ikeda faction, for instance. The last, Abe probably would call them dinosaurs, people who came out of this liberal lineage, Koga Makoto, for instance, Kato Koichi, they have retired from politics. And you have a very large number of younger people, younger parliamentarians who got elected the first time or only the second time in the 2012 election, in 2013 election too. So there aren't that many people who are veteran and senior enough within the party to stand up to Abe. And of course, his public support ratings help him an awful lot. So these things altogether have enabled Abe to actually pursue this ideological agenda that he could not pursue as, well, drastically during his first term. Now, the ramifications, and I will keep this brief, is that the way I see it is that we have the here the makings for at least a potentially vicious cycle, because the stronger Abe pushes his ideological agenda here in Japan, the more South Korea and the People's Republic of China will retaliate eventually, and you will eventually give even more breeding ground in all three countries for more nationalism. And, well, nationalism, as we know from this country's history, has potential, if you think only about what it was on the days in the news earlier today, the lady from NHK's board of directors commenting on the gentleman that, because he didn't like the Asahi, stormed into the Asahi headquarters in 1993 and shot himself in the head. For instance, right-wing violence, which we have lots and plenty of experience with in this country throughout, well, the first 30, 40 years of the post-war period, even though recently less so. So, as the old saying goes, if you're sitting in a glass house, it's not a smart idea to throw rocks. And the way I see it, when it comes to nationalism and patriotic education, all three countries are sitting in these glass houses and are busy throwing rocks at each other, but only see the other guy's bucket. So it's why are you throwing rocks at me? And, well, the Chinese say, no, you are throwing rocks at me. And so this is what makes the anti-vicious cycle even worse. So that would be, I guess I'm pretty much at 10 minutes. That would be all from my side. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them later. And this is just a cheap plug. If you are interested in learning more about constitution, you will probably, or constitutional reform, should I say, you will find, I guess, plenty in my book on the issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. After this short commercial break, we go straight to Sven Sahler.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Zoll, for the kind introduction. Thank you for the opportunity to speak here today. I will speak strictly as a historian. I'm a historian, so I'm not taking much into consideration political perspectives, probably, but just try to look at the past and try to look at what these things that we are debating here have led to in the past. First of all, and I'm sorry, I'm fighting with a cold, so I'm sorry for my voice. First of all, the Yasukuni visit by Mr. Abe last year in December, I think, first of all, was a matter of priority and choices. That is also very simple, I guess, as a starting statement, but I think we have to keep that in mind because a lot of the media do not discuss really whether there is actually a need to go to Yaskuni Shrine for the Prime Minister or not. The Prime Minister states that he has to, and that's very much it for this part of the discussion. But of course, as the head of the national government, I would suppose he would first of all go to the national, to a national memorial. There are plenty of choices in that respect. There is the Chidorigafuchi National Cemetery, which has this very authoritative name in English. So that would be a choice. In the declaration that he published after he visited the shrine, which has been distributed to you, he stated that he came to Yaskuni Shrine in order to pray for peace. However, the Yaskuni Shrine is not really a peace memorial. It is actually a war memorial. It was built in the 19th century in the context of an international context where many states started to build war memorials for the war dead. So it's strictly speaking not a peace memorial, although the shrine today on his homepage, etc., in his publications, tries to see to present itself as a peace memorial, but its origins clearly are a war memorial with a war museum. The Yushukan, which is in the shrine, is a war museum. It was founded as a war museum. So it sounds not as the most natural choice to go to the war memorial with a war museum to pray for peace. In Japan, there are plenty of peace museums, official museums, national or prefectural museums that he could visit if praying for peace would be the main point. So why did he make this choice to go to the Yaskuni Shrine? We do get some clues if we look not as the at the declaration he made in December, but rather as at his book Utsukushi Kuniye, Towards a Beautiful Country, which Dr. Winkler also already quoted. In this book, we will find a lot of statements of Mr. Abe showing that he is clearly critical of the, in Japanese society, generally accepted interpretation of the Asia-Pacific war as a war of aggression. If we look at opinion polls, that is generally accepted. If we look at historical science or history as an academic discipline, it is generally accepted amongst historians. Mr. Abe is critical of this interpretation. And the shrine, of course, shares the interpretation that he has of the history of the war, namely the idea that the war was a war of self-defense or maybe even a war for the liberation of East Asia. And that is the main point, I think, why he made this choice to go to the shrine and visit the shrine, because it has a similar understanding of history, which we can easily see in the Shrine Museum. That's where it's most most directly manifest, the interpretation of history of the shrine and of Mr. Abe. Mr. Abe also, in the statement that has been distributed to you, says that he feels remorse for the past. There's also a very important difference here. He speaks of remorse, while other prime ministers have used the term apology. The first prime minister to use the term apology was, interestingly, Mr. Hosokawa in 1993, and that was then reconfirmed with the Murayama statement. So his visit is, of course, a strong contradiction to the tradition of Japan's governments to the war, which since the 1990s have held the view that the war was a war of aggression, which is a view that he does not share, and that is one of the main reasons, I guess, why he visited the shrine. In his statement of December, he also speaks about reconciliation, but clearly in terms of priorities, to come back to that issue, the desire to visit the shrine is obviously stronger than reconciliation, because the visits to the shrine have been identified clearly by academics, by the media, and by politicians as one of the major obstacles to reconciliation in East Asia. So one can only conclude that reconciliation is not one of his priorities, but rather the expression of a certain view of history. So next I want to think a little bit about why he would make these kind of choices, why he would give priority to historical interpretations that are kind of relevant in a domestic context, but that clearly harm Japan's reputation in an international context. And basically, I would say, looking at Mr. Abe's book, for example, but also the declarations and statements of his administrations, his administration in the last months, I think that he and some of his ministers also are strongly influenced by emotions concerning history. Historical judgments normally should be made based on historical inquiry by historians mostly. But he and fellow politicians have strong emotions about history, which they put into their interpretations of history. And on a more basic level, I think the current administration lacks a basic understanding for historical issues in general. And I will now give a few examples of what I mean with that. For example, Mr. Abe, as previous prime ministers, has often declared that he will leave the judgment concerning historical issues to historians. This is something that has come up at least since the 1980s by a number of prime ministers. I leave the judgment of historical issues to historians. But as a matter of fact, he does not do that. He makes judgments about history, which are, on top of things, as I said before, not based on the historical consensus in Japanese society, and even less so on, which are contradictory to the consensus of history as an academic discipline. Another issue which shows that there is a basic lack for the understanding of historical issues is the claim that the Yasukuni issue is a domestic issue. That is also something that we can often hear from the government saying, well, this is a domestic issue, so foreign countries should not interfere in this domestic matter. However, as I said before, the Yasukuni Shrine is a war memorial. And in wars, normally, at least two parties do fight. At least two parties are involved in wars. So by definition, of course, the interpretation of a war is at least up to two sides. We can also observe worldwide that, of course, there are international debates about the historical interpretations of wars. So this is not an exception in East Asia, that there are discussions internationally about the interpretation of a war. But the Yasukuni Shrine is through Abe and others attempt to take the Yasukuni Shrine out of that and not let the interpretation of history in the shrine being scrutinized by historians and history as an academic field. In his book, it is quite interesting that, on the other hand, Mr. Abe states that he thinks history should not be interpreted in simplistic ways. He says it should not be interpreted, it should not be painted in black, white, or in good, bad. He uses the term akudama, zendama, zendama, akudama. He says this is not good, and it's actually, he speaks about his grandfather when he says that. However, I want to give you another few episodes which do suggest or illustrate that he argues in that way when it comes to his own history, his own family history, but not when it's about the history of the war in East Asia. And the prime example here, and since I'm running out of time, I think I will leave it to one example, is the explanation of his government spokesman a few weeks ago on the occasion of the opening of a memorial to the Korean independence fighter and assassin of Japan's first prime minister, Ito Hirobumi. Probably many of you have heard about this. Mr. Suga said the following on this Korean independence fighter and assassin, Mr. An Jung-gun. He said, and this is an unofficial translation by myself, he said, An assassinated the first prime minister of Japan and was sentenced to death as a terrorist. And he uses this term terrorist also in Japanese, terroristo in katakana. A one-sided interpretation of An and his acts on the side of Korea and China will not contribute to fostering peace and stability in East Asia. I think there are quite a number of things here that show that there is a basic lack of understanding for history. First, he speaks about a one-sided interpretation of history. The memorial was built after long deliberations between China and Korea. So at least two sides involved. It's not a one-sided interpretation of history. And this is actually a relatively rare example that two sides agree upon the building of a memorial of somebody from a different country on the soil of the other country. That's actually quite a remarkable achievement, I think. Then you might remember what I said, what Mr. Abe wrote about Zendama Akudama, the painting history in binary opposition in terms of black-white. Mr. Suga said, Japan, An was sentenced to death as a terrorist. First of all, the term terrorist probably was not used 100 years ago. But also, this was 100 years ago. So the Japanese government, indirectly, in the words of Suga, reconfirms this trial of 100 years ago and obviously misses out a lot of progress in historiography, which is discussing, of course, whether Mr. An was an assassin, a terrorist maybe even, or an independence fighter. And he probably was all of it. But indeed, in Japan, Mr. Suga and probably Mr. Abe as well do sue him only as a terrorist. There are, however, many of these cases in Japan and other cases in East Asia too. For example, in Japan, there is a lot of there are a lot of shrines and statues, for example, for a certain Toyotomi Hideyoshi, who was a warlord in the late 16th century who invaded Korea twice. Obviously, in Korea, he is remembered as an invader, as an aggressor. In Japan, he's still a major national hero, an example of particularly the potential of rising up in the social hierarchy. Probably the Koreans don't particularly like that, but I have never seen an official statement, at least from the Korean government, against the worship of Toyotomi Hideyoshi in Japan. And actually, also in the domestic context, there are plenty of statues in Japan of terrorists, actually, people who killed the people who later were brought about the overthrow of the Tokugawa shogunate, and the others too, those who defended the Tokugawa shogunate. You have statues and shrines and memorials for both sides. One side has to be terrorist, and there are many of these memorials all over Japan. So it is indeed difficult to judge whether somebody is a terrorist or a revolutionary or an independence fighter. And indeed, I think politicians should leave these judgments to historians. Unfortunately, that is not what is happening right now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sahler. So we go to Togo Sensei, please.
Thank you very much. So I would like to make 3 points. How I consider Yasukuni's, Prime Minister Abe's visit to Yasukuni diplomatically, and my conclusion is that this was a real diplomatic disaster. And secondly, I want to say a little bit, why did he go? But that has been already covered in many respects, so I will keep it short. And thirdly, I want to explain my own idea how we would get out from this diplomatic disaster. But let me state from the beginning that my idea is a very personal one, and I'm convinced that it would work, but I'm not convinced that Abe would follow it. So but this is maximum I can offer to this room. So diplomatic disaster. On the same day, December the 26th, 2013, China, Korea, United States, Russia, and European Union. By the end of the day of the 26th, they all came up with a public statement that Abe's visit to Yasukuni is problematic. 68 years ago, or more than 70 years ago, Japan fought Pacific War. With a psychology of being encircled by ABCD line, as you know, America, Britain, China, and Dutch. Now, if you compare the situation 68 years ago and today, in the situation which emerged after Abe's visit, European Union, the two major countries about which the two major countries which maintained difficult memories on war was Great Britain and Netherlands. America, notwithstanding, China, notwithstanding, and so to this list is now added Russia, which joined the war on August 1945, and Korea, which was a part of Japan at the, during World War II. The only country or area which is missing here is probably Taiwan. But Abe, by this single visit, succeeded in creating an encirclement of Japan. Now, not this time, not physically, but certainly culturally. And in my own thinking, this was the situation which I really dreaded and I feared, that after Japan's defeat, physical defeat, 68 years ago, now Japan is going to face a cultural, moral defeat. And with this single action, Abe succeeded in creating this encirclement, a real disaster. In addition, the timing was really disastrous, because from September 2012, after China began to enter into the territorial waters of Senkaku, Japan, in my view, is really in a from the point of view of our security and defense, we are under existential threat. China, whatever views they have on Senkaku, entering into the territorial waters once a week, Japan unable to stop it. This situation continues, is unpermissible, and is so dangerous. So the responsibility of the prime minister is to tackle this issue and do something about it. In addition, internationally, the fact that China using physical forces to change the status quo made China's position difficult. In all my interlocutions last year, I have not seen any country which is supporting this China's new approach to change the status quo by force. So relatively speaking, Japan was in a good position internationally. With this single action, Japan gave China a causes to distract international attention from the Senkaku issue and achieve what they really want to achieve at this point, which is continuing present-day incursion to the territorial waters of Senkaku, thus gradually changing the status quo. United States. People talk a lot, what was the reaction of the United States? But in my view, as an ally of the United States, we do not need to ask the Americans what to do. We have to make our own judgment what is the real interest of the United States, and it is very clear. I think in anybody the responsible in the U.S. United States side, the real issue is rise of China. This is a difficult issue. For us, it's difficult, but for the Americans, it is also difficult. So clearly, the Americans don't want a war between Japan and China. Clearly, Americans don't want Japan to provoke China. We don't need to be told by the Americans this. So it's really primary students, minimal sort of joshiki desu ne. Common sense. So it was a real diplomatic disaster, I have no words to add to it. Why did this happen? Well, as Dr. Winkler mentioned, he wanted, clearly he wanted, and he could domestically, yes. And probably there was a lack of adequate intelligence around him. But maybe there was intelligence, but Abe didn't want to see the intelligence. I don't know. But there was clearly one fact of misjudgment of priority. To me, the single issue which the Prime Minister of Japan today has to think is the issue of war and peace. Because we are faced for the first time after the end of the war, a real situation of war and peace. And what we should do in this, or our Prime Minister should do in this, is to have deterrent power. So Abe's enhancement of Japan's defense capability, okay. But another one is dialogue. And the first element of dialogue is trying to create personal relations of trust. And for this, avoiding provocation is the first policy we should take. And this is the Prime Minister's responsibility vis-a-vis Japanese people. And going to Yasukuni at this point precisely goes against it. What can I say? So what to do? What to do? And here I go back to the proposal, which I wrote 7 years ago. And I asked to distribute this. This is this moratorium on Yasukuni's visit, which was published in June 2006, so 7 years ago. The logic is a little bit complicated. So I try to state it very quickly. But my basic position that I am a supporter of Yasukuni. My view is that Yasukuni is the best place for the Japanese to mourn the war dead. But not today's Yasukuni. There are certain aspects we have to revise it and change it, and then eventually bring Yasukuni into the harmony with ourselves and with surrounding countries. So my proposal was that Japan should introduce these changes of Yasukuni, during which period Prime Minister should refrain from visiting. And after Yasukuni being remodeled, restructured, not only Prime Ministers, but other dignitaries from abroad and so on, would visit Yasukuni. There are two issues I proposed then to restructure on Yasukuni. One was the issue of war responsibility, and the second was the issue of museum. Now, the war responsibility, now logic is a bit complicated. Five point. First, there was a Tokyo tribunal, and there was a judgment, and Japan accepted by Article 11 of San Francisco Peace Treaty this judgment. No derogation from it. No responsible politicians, including myself, considers to derogate from that responsibility. But two, there has been criticism about Tokyo Tribunal, both from the point of view of right and from point of view of the left in Japan. There has been a long years of soul searching. And if you are my contention that if you are critical on the judgment, then Japan should come up with our own decision, own evaluation of the history. Were the Japanese people lazy not to have come to any conclusion? No. My contention is after 50 years, the Murayama statement was the height of Japan's evaluation of our own on war responsibility issue. And this is a position about which Japan can be proud of. But three, there is one aspect which was not entirely clear in Murayama's statement. Murayama's statement basically says Japan committed aggression and colonial ruling, and I'm sorry. Very simple and very clear. But what is this Japan? And here comes in this difficult question which turns the Japanese mind. The responsibility of the leaders and the soldiers who are caught by Akagami, red paper we call. This aspect has not been discussed. So we need to come, this is not because China told us, but this is an aspect which Japan itself has to consider ourselves. Now, the ultimate debate will lead into two directions. If you agree that the leaders are responsible, then this could be connected to Yasukuni, and the conclusion eventually should be destroying the 14 class A criminals. But
if you accept that Japan as a whole was responsible in some way or other, then there will be an entirely new way of dealing with this issue. The fourth, that debate was intermingled with China's position. And this is related to the 1972 Zhou Enlai statement. Zhou Enlai said then that in revising our relationship, Zhou Enlai stated that Japanese militarist leaders are common enemy of the Japanese people and the Chinese people. In the history, historical record tell us that no Japanese prime minister from Tanaka Kakue onwards, nobody had said anything about it. Naturally, China has a reason to consider that Japan basically acknowledged this position, tacitly, if not openly. So from China's point of view, it is not natural to say that then who are these Japanese militarist leaders? There are only one name, 14A crime war, 14 class A war criminals enshrined in Yasukuni. So from their point of view, it is natural to tell the Japanese, at least don't pay respect to them. In addition, there is one more aspect for us to think. From 1975 onwards, Emperor Showa has never visited Yasukuni. Current emperor is not going there. And for Yasukuni supporter like myself, the key question, why does not emperor go? So what I wanted to beg for Koizumi, Abe, and all other sort of so-called right-wing Yasukuni supporters, the primary issue is not you. The primary issue for the politicians is to change Yasukuni and create a new structure in which the emperor would go with a harmonious mind in his mind. That is the responsibility of prime minister. I sometimes feel really appalled. You know, they think that they want, it's okay for them to go, but it's not okay. Now, so this is a long but difficult issue. And the next issue is museum. We have to change Yasukuni in a pure place of mourning. And the historical narrative is not necessary. So somehow Japan should dissociate Yusukan from Yasukuni and create a new national museum which has a much wider perspective. Now, this is all written here. Now, Abe has gone there once. So my advice is to face this issue a little more straightforwardly and to resolve this issue as a Japanese, during which period he should stop going, so moratorium. I think it would work, and I think it's the national task for us to do something about it. But I think the analysis you deployed do not necessarily suggest that he will listen to my advice. So I don't know. I have some comment to both of you, but I stop here.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Togo-sensei. Before we go into Q&A, I would quickly like to ask Dr. Sadler, because you have done research about alternatives to today's Yasukuni Shrine. Do you think Togo-sensei's proposal is an option to change the whole problem?
I think it will be very difficult. I mean, as you already stated, quite a number of preconditions, like dismantling or at least changing very much the museum, taking out the souls of the 14 war criminals from those
venerated. One option. This is
one option.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
One option. Yeah. Well, but I think these things would be necessary in order to make the Yasukuni Shrine internationally acceptable memorial. But I don't think that will happen in the near future. And here, for good or for bad, we do have the freedom of religion in Japan. So, of course, it's the shrine's right to have its own interpretation of history. I do see the problem more in terms of political institutions, which Dr. Winkler also said. The shrine is a private institution. It's one religion among many in Japan. So I think, of course, it was the national memorial in the pre-war period. But for both reasons, because it's not the national memorial anymore, and because it had a very difficult role or critical role in the pre-war period, it would be very difficult to strip it of its history, and which also is manifested in the museum, and make it into an acceptable memorial. That's what I think. I'm not against this option. That's not what I'm saying. I just think it's very unlikely, and that's why I think it's more likely that Japanese politicians would be more likely to succeed with just choosing a different option, namely going to Chidoriga Fuji peace memorials or one of the hundreds of war memorials that you do have in Japan. Yeah.
Togo-sensei, many times when I hear you speaking, you're trying to put yourself into the feet of the other party. You're trying to see the problem from the Chinese side, or when we talk about the northern territories, the southern Kuriles, you try to put yourself in the shoes of the Russians. With your proposal, putting yourself in the shoes of the Chinese or the Koreans, do you think they will manage to make this shift, to see Yasukuni in a new way?
Yasukuni issue for the Koreans is a different issue. For the Koreans, Yasukuni issue is primarily related to the 20,000 or so of the Koreans who are actually enshrined there. This is a very difficult issue. Japan and Korea have so many problems now. And my advice for the Japan-Korea relations is that we should tackle other several major issues, and then eventually this issue would remain as an unsolved issue. But I have no answer. But 20,000 Koreans, basically, all families do not want the spirit to be enshrined. That has to be sorted. With China, I am convinced that there could be a way out. Because one approach is this de-enshrinement of 14 class A of criminals. I think this would meet the fundamental logic with the Chinese. My difficulty here is that, as I said, this is a difficult issue for us. Is one way of thinking is delineating leaders' responsibility vis-a-vis the soldiers who were caught by Akagami. But another way is to take the Murayama statement as a basis for accepting responsibility of the Japanese as a whole. Now, this is a very difficult issue, and how to let the all other outside world understand what we mean by it. There are several long paths and actions to be taken. But if we formulate our position there, then this means that the Class A war criminals were died to take responsibility of Japan as a whole in their own life. Here we have, then we will have some reason to visit these 14 Class A war criminals. Now, to let the Chinese understand this, I tried once 2 years ago in a public forum with a respectable Chinese interlocutor. But it was more difficult to talk about this issue than the Senkaku issue. So, I am not optimistic there. But this is very difficult. But still, if we are determined and if the whole Japanese are more or less united on this line and take time, no rush, then there should be a way. That's my view. I mean, I'm not optimistic either.
Okay, with that, we're going to open to the floor for questions. Yes, please, back there. While she's taking the microphone, please, to everybody, can come up, to everybody, make them short. And if we address your question to one of them, please tell who should answer. And don't forget your name and affiliation, please.
Judith Stalpers, Elsevier Magazine in the Netherlands. It's probably mostly directed to Togo-san. There's a diplomatic issue here, and maybe also to the historians. There have been two events also. One by Abe-san at Davos, the World Economic Forum. He referred to the first, the pre-First World War statement, where the UK and Germany were in a similar relationship as China and Japan are right now. That is maybe a question to the historian, if this comparison is is a good one. Then there's another thing. This is a quotation from Helmut Schmidt, the Eminence Grise in Germany, who said last week, the USA is on an isolationist tour. They are pulling back from foreign policies for several reasons, but he explicitly also mentioned the USA will not fight for a few small Chinese, for islands in the East China Sea. How, Togo-sensei, do you see this diplomatic development or this international development?
May I? Please go ahead. About the first question, Prime Minister's statement on Davos. What I understand fundamentally is that World War developed from an incident, a minor incident, which was thought then, but by way of other circumstances, developed into a devastating total war. Now, the situation in East Asia, as you mentioned, this issue of around minor rocks. Nobody, you know, realistically consider it rational that this will develop into a major skirmishes, and possibly a major war between Japan and China. It's outstandingly, it's crazy. But I think what we have to be warned is the lesson of the history, and to express our determination so that this kind of unthinkable, illogical development should never happen. My feeling that Abe has not made the last point very clear. And so it gave an impression that he's foreseeing it. I think as a politician, he should have said right from the beginning that this kind of, we should learn from the history and never let this happen. At least this is my view. Now, about Chancellor Schmidt's statement that the United States will never fight on account of the small rocks, not entirely agreeable. You have to see the whole circumstances. Yeah, clearly, it's so irrational. But if China uses forces to change the status quo, I don't think Japan nor the United States fundamentally can accept it. So naturally, the key question is how to prevent these kind of things happen. And as I said, there's only two approaches, deterrence and dialogue. So United States is really asking Japan, as a responsible ally, not to provoke China so that their policy would not become worse. But if China's determination is to change the status quo by force, and this, if the small rocks become representative issue on this line, I think United States will act. And that is the basis of the alliance. But for this, Japan's government has to be responsible, credible, and trustworthy enough. And going to Yasukuni precisely destroyed this foundation. So this is my view is a real failure.
Mr. Sari, would you like to add something maybe on the historic comparison?
Yeah, just
and if people are actually able to learn from history?
Yeah, that is a very good question. History tells us that people do not learn from history usually. But basically, of course, I would completely agree with what Professor Togo already said. Maybe just to add that, of course, when you make these historical parallels, again, you have a choice. You can, of course, compare the present situation between Japan and China with the situation of Germany and England or Britain before World War I, and there are, of course, probably some similarities, but as Professor Togo already said, you are then making the point that there probably will be war at some point. That is at least how this kind of statement can be understood. It can be understood as a warning, but as you said, he did not clearly say, let's learn from history. So some people obviously could understand this as a warning, while he had, of course, choices. Germany and Britain, that was a war that was fought eventually. There are in history plenty of wars that were not fought eventually, but were avoided. So he could have also chosen a different comparison, I suppose. But again, it's about choices. He chose to make this comparison and not a different one. So I think that does tell us something about the situation.
Dr. Winkler, would you like to add something?
I guess most of it has already been said, but as far the and if I understand it, that would be sort of a suggestion that a return to the Monroe Doctrine that the United States has held in the early 20th century of saying that we will focus more on our domestic issues. I don't believe that the wording in the Mutual Security Assistance Treaty leaves any wiggle room here. So if China were, as Togo Sensei said, to change the status quo, then the U.S. had a treaty obligation to actually act along with Japan and fight, even if it didn't want to. And particularly because U.S. politicians have said multiple times that the Senkaku Islands fall under the Anpo.
Dr. Winkler, you showed us before the environment which allowed Abe-san to go to Yasukuni. Does this environment also allow him to step down, to de-escalate? Or is there a push to be strong, to be to not back down?
On these foreign policy issues, or generally on Yasukuni?
Vis-à-vis China, can he steer a softer course vis-à-vis China, or is the pressure too hard?
No, there is. I don't think there is any pressure at all, because these foreign policy issues do not decide elections. When everything's said and done, probably the last election or the last elections that have been fought over policy issues were in the early 1960s, during the Anpo Tosa, for instance. I don't think there is any foreign policy has ever had that sound effect that it would sort of affect or have anything, if not a negative effect, on the LDP's chances of winning the next election. So the people that feel very strongly about this issue, they are very few and far in between. So from perspective of the party or sort of chances of staying in power, probably would make far more sense for Abe to sort of seek this reconciliatory tone that Togo Sensei mentioned. Why? Because if you look at the reasons the people voted for the LDP in 2012, why they returned the party to power, even though they were totally fed up with it by 2009, was fixing relations with foreign countries. Because people thought, well, after the Senkaku incidents and the Noda administration's handling of the nationalization of the islands, the DPJ didn't have the experience to do so. And then you can say, well, yes, there has been nobody else in Japanese politics that has this kind of experience other than the LDP. And they have in the past made deals, for instance, with the Chinese in 72. There was sort of reason for optimism that the LDP would come back and use its considerable connections to Beijing, but also its experience in government to restore these relations. And to a certain degree, and to discredit Prime Minister Abe when he came into power the first time, actually managed to do so by not going to Yasukuni. So foreign policy alongside, well, economic recovery and then a stable government was sort of the main reason the LDP got this chance to be in power again. And clearly, we can argue about economics, about Abenomics, for instance, and a stable government. But clearly, on the foreign policy side, they did not deliver.
Okay, I'll open the floor again, please. Yeah, go ahead.
My name is Crowell. I'm a freelance writer here. Couldn't the United States end this Yasukuni nonsense pretty in one stroke if it issued a formal protest, even in conjunction with the Chinese and the South Koreans? After all, we're the ones who put the 14 guys, convicted them of war crimes. Why are we not willing to defend our legacy in World War II?
I don't think a real public statement by the United States will help. Because as I said, this is a very complex issue inside Japan. And to me, the best environment for us is to be engaged in this soul searching, which we have not yet finished, in a quiet environment. And there's naturally one prerequisite that we will not become lazy, that we will tackle this issue and come to our own conclusion. And I'm afraid to say that in the last seven years when I proposed the moratorium was kept, but basically nobody done anything. So the past record is not very bright. But being pressured from outside, I think would intensify the tensions within the society. And the worst outcome of it is to have some erratic reaction. So quiet advice is welcome, particularly to the right politician who have only one solution, is to just to go. To tell them that this is not helpful, and this can harm the Japanese national interest. That kind of quiet advice is most welcome. But that's my view.
The question was open to all three. Would any of you like to add something? Okay, back to the floor, Siegfried.
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. If Mr. Abe goes to the shrine to express his different view on history, on his different view on the Tokyo Tribunal, is this not directed against the United States? Because United States was the war was against the United States, and the tribunal was organized mostly by the United States. So in this way, is this not a kind of a bomb in Japan-US relations?
First, for the historical aspect, Dr. Stahl, if you would like to say something.
Basically, I think you are absolutely right. I mean, his writings, also in his book, he is very critical of the United States. His whole concept of overcoming the war, the post-war regime, is of course implicitly directed against the post-war control of Japan by the United States. However, he always phrases that implicitly. He never directly challenges the relation and the alliance with the United States. In his book, he actually confirms explicitly the alliance, the necessity of the alliance with the United States. So I guess that's another field where he just is not very consistent. He knows, I mean, it's also that he's in an ambiguous position. He knows that Japan needs the United States for its defense, but he wished that Japan could be able to be more independent, including foreign policy and defense policy, which it is not. So whenever he goes into that direction, of course, these kind of problems come up, and the Yasukuni Shrine is one example where the United States, as we have heard, have made a statement for the very first time, and it was also reported in the newspapers that Vice President Biden called Mr. Abe to persuade him to not go to the shrine. So obviously there is some tension here at work. But I guess still, in terms of security issues in East Asia, Japan and the United States still need each other. So for the time being, this also relates to your question before, I don't think the United States will publicly make a a stronger criticism than they did in December of Mr. Abe, and definitely they won't do that with China, maybe somehow with Korea, but definitely not with China, because of course that would be very much against the spirit of the Japanese-American alliance. So I think he is on a very narrow path here, Mr. Abe, because implicitly much of what he says and does is directed against the United States or against the control of Japan by the United States, but it's just not possible, of course, to completely challenge the relation with the United States.
Dr. Winkler, you said in your presentation that for the Abe administration it was a surprise how strong the U.S. reacted. Togo-sensei, when we talked before we came into this room, you said personally you were not surprised at all. Was it a surprise?
May I just mention something to the,
please,
to the previous question? I don't believe it's a contradiction per se. There is a long debate among conservative intellectuals, many of whom have had profound influence on Abe. And sort of one key point that led to the split of the Atarashii Rikishi Kyokusho Tsukurukai, the Association of School Books, this controversial organization that fell apart 6 or 7 years ago, was over the Iraq War. And there, one of the founders of this organization made the claim that Seiji Tushisu Abetsu. So politics and political thought are different. And that's exactly what you see at work here. Seiji is, in this case, as Professor Sala just explained before, the foreign policy relation with the United States. Most conservative intellectuals and Abe will tell you that, well, if we cut this alliance, then, well, the Chinese will stand in Okinawa tomorrow and next month in Kyushu. So we cannot do this, even though we don't like it. That being said, again, Seiji Tushisu Abetsu, so the political thought issue is different. And political thought here means domestic issues, and it means the post-war regime. And conservatives have never accepted it. Part of it the conservative mainstream has, but conservative intellectuals never have. And from my experience, they never will, and Abe has been very strongly influenced by people like Eto John Fukuda Tsuneyori, who have made it very clear that the post-war regime, the U.S., as it's always called in Japan, the U.S. imposed constitution, is or was a forced import of U.S. values, progressism, liberalism, that people don't like. And so the first part is, to some degree, shikata ganai. We can't change it, can't be helped for the time being. But the second part, from that perspective, is indeed changeable. That is, for instance, different to Germany, where people said, even conservative intellectuals, we cannot go back to pre-1945. In Japan, generally among conservative intellectuals, there is a consensus that we don't have to go back, and what happened before 1945 wasn't all that great, but we must not allow the Americans to cut that lineage off, that we have these splendid 2,000 years of, well, Japanese history and traditions. And Abe is in that sort of line of thought and Lynch, and this is one thing that is expressed implicitly, though, but in Utsukushi Kuniye, too.
May I just very shortly add that I completely agree with what you're saying, but I still think it's a contradiction, or it leads to the contradictions policy decisions and the tensions that we see in the Yasukuni issue, that you have a different shiso, a different ideology than you actually practice. And in the long term, that just doesn't work, or it does lead to tensions.
Coming back to the U.S.-Japanese relations today, was the reaction a surprise or not? Or to be expected?
I don't have any inside knowledge, of course, but I would say that probably the Japanese government did not see that one coming. And as Togo-sensei said before, probably within, given Abe's popularity right now still, he doesn't seem to listen to an awful lot of people or external advisors, maybe Hamada-sensei, who is his economic brain. But usually it seems to be mostly that Abe makes these decisions in conjunction with Mr. Suga, who is not ideologically different from him. And nobody has told him that, well, maybe you will find yourself at least morally encircled by the end of the day if you let your ideology get the better of, well, your political decision-making. So I don't think that the government expected this, by historical standards, rather harsh reaction from Washington.
Togo-sensei, does Abe have bad advisors when it comes to international relations, or does he not listen to them?
those foreign ministry-related advisors around Abe, the key 5-10 people that I know, in a way, I think are the best and brightest. And I do not doubt that they are giving Abe the best advices we can do. And they cannot say openly what they think. But my personal conviction is that what they think is very much the same as I try to explain today. They naturally, they cannot say with the frankness I'm saying. Now, there are politicians around Abe. to the best I know, the intelligence and information which they bring to Abe in many instances are very remote to what is happening in the outside world. Now, my understanding until December the 25th last year was that Abe were prepared to listen both, and Abe, the pragmatist, in taking decisions on foreign policy, inclined to listen much more to the first sort of foreign ministry-related advices. Now I am not sure. After December the 26th, I am not sure. So this is really what troubles me. Further than that, maybe you know more than I do. But I clearly see discrepancies of advices, intelligent, going to Abe from these, roughly speaking, two circles. And it is going to become critically important for Abe to whom he's going to listen.
Mr. Saler, you would like to add something?
Yeah, just a very short follow-up. Maybe the American statement came as a surprise, but I don't think it was surprising at all. Already in late 2012, actually before Mr. Abe became prime minister, there were a number of statements like in the New York Times concerning his historical views. A American think tank wrote the following. And I quote, Abe's revisionist historical statements on Japan's wartime actions are indeed troubling and would needlessly exacerbate regional tensions. It would be helpful to privately counsel Abe not to push his revisionist history agenda. Retracting previous Japanese government statements on Japanese wartime actions, as Abe has recommended, would needlessly inflame long simmering regional animosity. Instead, Japan should revise its statements of atonement and apology in ways that will satisfy Korean sensitivities. So this is not an official statement from the United States, but is from a publication in a Washington-based think tank. So all of this was, of course, out there in the air, and therefore I don't think it's particularly surprising that eventually the United States came up with a statement.
Martin, you wanted to add something or ask something?
Yeah, I want Martin Kölling, Handelsblatt from Germany. I wanted to ask one question. The one problem many people outside of Japan have with the apology of Japanese prime ministers is it genuine? Many people think, okay, the prime minister might issue an apology, but then his ministers are going to the shrine. Most people think along the same lines. Basically, there's a kind of double speak in Japan. In the case of Prime Minister Abe, an apology would be so clearly for everybody, double standard. Yeah, he is so clearly not behind it. Will it be? Can it work? Can an apology by this prime minister, who has such a clearly revisionist agenda, who has so clearly stated views on policy, is an apology of this person believable for the outside world?
Who wants to tackle that difficult question? Diplomats have answers for everything, so I'll give you the word first, Togo-sensei.
On the whole, I am convinced that the apology is sincere. Partly because I am sincere. But, you know, still this is important. Because everybody who responds to this question have to take it personally, in my view. If you are yourself is not sincere, and if you are not convinced, it's very difficult to convince others. But secondly, I hasten to add that the issue is very complex, and it is not like Germany. It's not crystal clear. And during the Cold War, it was less embedded. It was not on the forefront. But after the end of the Cold War, the issue came on the forefront. And the way Murayama's statement was composed, and the way Murayama's statement follow up, it was not a simple procedure, as you mentioned. But I don't think it means that Murayama's statement was formed with insincerity. I don't think it is that Murayama's statement was followed with insincerity. There is a kind of overall consensus of the Japanese people reflective in this statement. And this very hard to prove in statistics. But at least as a person who lived this generation, I was born in 1945, who went through the whole process of soul searching in Japan, both from right and left. There's an amazing amount of documents which come from both right and left. It's gradually developed to Murayama's statement, and at least foreign policy-wise, foreign ministry has based in its policy of reconciliation from 1995 to today, Murayama's statement. This is rock solid. And I also made some personal research, and I reread it, and I rediscovered the power of the language of this statement, which is expressed in a very kind of Asian way of expression, with some vagueness. Still, I am convinced that we can add much more of spirituality on this statement. But this is in process. So what can I say? There are serious intellectual who is so critical about Murayama's statement, including one of the former ambassador Murata, vice minister for foreign affairs. He passed away 2 years ago. But please, if you read Japanese, please read the books he wrote and published before he died. It's an astonishing statement which criticized fundamentally Murayama, but he's not the right winger. No, going around. He's one of the best Japanese intellectuals and still so critical against Murayama's statement. I know another vice minister for foreign affairs who helped writing this statement. Even within the foreign ministry, there are discrepancy of views. Does it mean that we are insincere? I don't think so. This shows that how the issue is difficult, and yet in my view, the overall rising consensus in direction is clear. But it is, after all, a product of political consensus. My own position that I have to do everything personally in order to consolidate this direction. I may fail. I don't know. And what is come after? I don't know.
Anything to add?
I don't know whether I would be that optimistic. I guess that the problem is, as you mentioned, there is a question of really honen tatemai, of whether the state. I don't doubt that former Prime Minister Hosokawa and Murayama, they were sincere, and the people who drafted that on the LDP side, for instance, people like Nonaka Hiromu, who lived through the war, that these people were sincere. What happened afterwards, I guess, is a completely different issue. I mean, if you look at the past decade, even under Koizumi, people got reprimanded. Cabinet members, for instance, got reprimanded when they said, well, you know, the term comfort women did not really exist until 45. And then Koizumi had Fukuda and later his chief cabinet secretary, Hosoda, tell these people to shut up. there were instances where these people were fired. Nowadays, everybody can say whatever they want. So that has changed. And that obviously, all these statements that people make with regard to comfort women, with history school books, going to Yasukuni, all these things add up. And it's not that they stay inside Japan, right? I mean, people always assume because it's in Japanese and foreigners don't understand Japanese, it will stay in Japan, and it doesn't. The internet is a very powerful tool, and a lot of stuff gets translated previously instantly, and then it's on the news, and it's in the international news. And then it comes back as a boomerang. And these things, I do believe, these instances that we have on a rather frequent occasion have severely damaged, if not undermined, whatever good faith that sort of has manifested itself in the Murayama statement and since then.
I see two more hands up. Togo Sensei also passed me a paper. He would like to say a few words about the memorial to An Zhonggong in China. Is any of your questions related to that by any chance? Why don't you take 2 minutes quickly and then we give the next question. Yes, please.
There's one aspect about An Zhonggong that is hardly reported here. In Japan, there are a substantial number of intellectuals who are basically strongly supporting An Zhonggong. And this dates back from the Meiji period. It starts with his prison guard, Chiba Jushi, who created the personal relations with An and who became as a deep admirer of An, so to say, and who had three times real conversation with An. And Chiba told An that, "I feel so sorry about this happened." And An was very surprised. And Chiba asked An to leave his calligraphy. An said, I'm too busy writing other things. But on the morning of the execution, An called Chiba, and now I will leave my last testimony. And this is the main meaning is that to devote yourself for the country is the mission of a military person. And Chiba brought this back as his personal family treasure. And every morning in Japan, he prayed for An. Now, not only Chiba, but the Meiji period who saw An, saw in An a spirit of real patriot. And there were, An's calligraphy became very popular in the Meiji period. The Meiji people had a much broader understanding of An, not as a terrorist, but as a patriot. But the most striking thing is that Okazaki Hisahiko, you know, the chief architect of Abe, 30 years ago, he worked as a young diplomat in Seoul. And he wrote a book. You know, he was, by definition, a real historian scholar. He made a lot of research and wrote a book, Tonari no Kuri de Kangaeta Koto, What I Thought in My Neighboring Country. And here he wrote 3-4 pages of a kind of homage to An Zhonggong. And he writes that there was an American friend in Seoul. And Okazaki asked, what do you think about An? And this American friend told him that he was a Korean terrorist. Then Okazaki wrote that, no, he was a patriot. And when the time come that Americans would understand An Zhonggong to be a patriot, we are going to enter into a better world. Now, An Zhonggong, lastly, before one of his last writing, wrote that in future, when we have a better world, Japan, China, and Korea should create an East Asian community with common banks, common police activities. This was the vision with which he died. Does President Park know about it? Does Mr. Mr. Suga knows about it? This is a problem because for a person of my generation, it's not necessarily new. The good news is that there was a Shimon Shimizu response recently, and the government gave a view on An, and they avoided
they stroke out the wording of terrorist. Mm. Now, so the official position, we have striken out terrorist. But, you know, China and Korea getting together to squeeze Japan on Ancheon, something is terribly wrong. Partly this is due to the shallowness of our historical knowledge, but partly I think this is due to the lack of initiative that this Ancheon could have turned into a symbol of East Asian community. We should have taken much more initiative for this. You're not agreeing?
No, I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, but yeah, it is on the record. Yeah. But Okazaki's book is retranslated into a few days ago, but with a different title. The first title was Tonari no Kui de Kangaeta Koto, what I thought in the American. But current book is Why the Japanese Hate Koreans So Much. It's
okay.
But the content of the book is exactly the same. There's no revision.
And that's... Mr. Saller has a few words to add.
Yeah, just a piece of information for those of you who are interested in the views of An Jung-kung on East Asian community. This text is also translated into English. So if you look for it on Google, you will find actually several versions by now, including one that is published in a book that I have edited. So it's actually really an astonishing phenomenon that this kind of East Asian community ideas were not only advocated in Japan by Japanese, but also by Koreans until a certain time, basically until the annexation of Korea in 1910.
Good. Michael, you have a question.
Michael Penn of the Shingetsu News Agency. And I guess this is mostly for Togo Sensei. The Yomiuri account of Abe's decision to go to Yasukuni was quite a striking one. What it basically said was that, first of all, Mr. Ishiba, the Secretary General, was completely taken off guard by the decision to go to Yasukuni on December 26th. In fact, the reporters surrounding him knew about it before he did. And when they said, oh, what do you think about the Yasukuni visit? He said, why are you asking me about Yasukuni? Because he totally was left in the dark. And the Yomiuri account also suggests that even Suga, his closest advisor and collaborator, had, till the last minute, argued him not to do it. So when we talk about the advisors and the decision to go to Yasukuni, at least according to the Yomiuri account, it really all came down to just Abe himself, even in the face of all of his advisors. What do you think about that?
What I heard that Suga tried to stop him. I mean, but this is not a kind of proven sources information. But Suga was not. Suga was advising him not to go. But Abe himself and several of the political circles around him strongly advised. Now, one word about Yomiuri. Watanabe Tsuneo, who is still, I think, there are many Japanese journalists here, so correct me if I'm wrong. But Watanabe Tsuneo, who is still one kind of mastermind of Yomiuri Shimbun, very critical against Abe's visit to Yasukuni. Mm-hmm. And so on other issues, Yomiuri and Sankei are usually considered the conservative newspapers of Japan, and Asahi and Mainichi are kind of more liberal. But on this issue, there is a kind of interesting alliance between Asahi and Yomiuri, which revealed most in 2006. Mm. I just happened to see New Year television where Nakasone and Watanabe had talks at Nihon Terebi. Very interesting. Watanabe practically gave three or four choices which Prime Minister could have taken other than going to Yasukuni, on other than Yasukuni itself. On mourning the war dead. So naturally, I think not Yomiuri would have reported views such as you outline.
We're almost running out of time. Would you allow me to take one last question from the floor? Yes, Carson, you had a question.
Carsten Gammes from Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, Germany. Up to now, we're talking about some conservative Japanese elite project. This is what Abe wants, the conservative right-wingers and LDP want. How far does it change and affect Japanese society Is there some sort of trend to the more nationalistic society, or is it just an elite project and society simply doesn't care what's happening? Mr. Abe, when he was here in 2012 before the party election, said that he learned the lesson from his first failure. And it's a bit like Bill Clinton, stupid, it's the economy. So people were not interested in nationalistic constitutional reforms, they were interested in the economic situation. This is the same today. Abenomics, and I personally would call it the Corona bubble, works. So still people are more concerned about the economic situation, about income. Is this only a Japanese elite project, or will it really change Japanese society in a more nationalist way?
I guess we will see that. If you ask me in 10 years, I probably can answer that question. From everything we've seen, opinion polls, etc., you're perfectly right. People don't care. As a matter of fact, constitutional support for constitutional reform has gone up and down, but it has gone down quite a bit compared to its peak in 2004, even in the Yomiuri polls. So in a way, constitutional reform has always been a conservative pet project of certainly in numbers a very small elite, but a very influential elite. Whether it is changing, you hear, or I've been hearing conservatives for a long, long time say, yes, things are changing. We're going to break the Asahi Iwanami regime and turn this into a real country. Again, whether that is happening, well, opinion polls don't show it. Also, if you look at, for instance, sales figures for right-wing opinion magazines and the like, for the most part, they have gone down quite drastically, in line with other publications, of course. So to say that Japan as a whole is drifting to the right is something that, at least as a scholar, I would say there is no evidence for it. So what you have, however, and that you've, I guess, sort of given the answer yourself already, is that because there is a focus on economics and people are totally fed up with any talk about reform, and saying, well, we've given the DPJ a chance and they messed it up. And so now we only want a stable government. We don't want any more Nejide Kokkai anymore. And we want finally, after, well, 2 decades of, well, no growth at all, we want more money. There is no, I don't think, any strong push in either direction from the general public. However, because thus far this Abenomics project has gone fairly well, Abe can go ahead with this agenda. If you remember in 2007, the pension scandal sort of came in the way. This time, so far, it has been smooth sailing. And unless you have some internal or external shock, I don't think that Abe will be derailed as easily as he was in 2007.
Well, as a Swiss, I see it's 2-0-2, and my heart is bleeding to go on. But I would like to give the word to both of them. Mr. Salo, why don't you go first, and then you will have the last word, please.
Yes, Mr. Salo. Yeah, just very shortly. I mean, basically, I think Dr. Winkler already explained this adequately. I also don't see really a drift to the right, which is often, as it is often framed in the media. I mean, this is actually the field of Dr. Winkler. The last elections didn't really show a drift of the right. They just showed that the voters ran away from the DPJ, but the LDP didn't even win a lot of votes. And by now, the support rate for the Restoration Party, which is probably even right of the LDP, has been massively dropping, and they might not win any seats anymore in the next elections. Just a week ago, actually, on the weekend, in television, you always see the support rates for the parties following opinion polls. Last weekend or 2 weekends ago, I actually saw the numbers, and I was surprised to see the Japanese Communist Party coming in second after the LDP. So I don't think that's much proof or evidence for a drift to the right. But of course, what we do see is, as Dr. Winkler also already said, that people do not care enough about politics. That's why the traditional voters go to the elections and vote for the LDP. But a lot of people don't go to the elections, first of all. And if they go, their voting behavior is definitely not much influenced by questions like the Yasukuni Shrine, foreign policy, or even history issues. That is definitely something that we can observe in previous elections. So even relatively conservative or almost right-wing politicians are being elected, that also does not mean necessarily a drift to the right. It just means that the election decision is made on different, following different criteria, and of course economic issues, and that's a global phenomenon everywhere, of course, come in first here. If you look at opinion polls concerning history, and that's what my book that is also listed up in the in my introduction for today's event was about. I looked at how opinion polls were on historical issues, on the interpretations of history. And after my book, there were other opinion polls. There are no recent ones, so I don't know what changed in the last 3 or 5 years. But until 5 years ago or so, it was very clear public opinion would not really have a strong tendency towards revisionist views of the past. People who would say that the World War II was a war of self-defense or even a war of Asian liberation would be really a minority of 10 to 15%, which is usually in any society the potential for right-wing views, even in Europe. Right now we have actually in Europe much stronger percentages for right-wing parties. So altogether, I completely agree with Dr. Winkler that I also don't see a drift to the right, but of course a drift to the right in politics, in particular within the LDP, which, as Dr. Winkler said in a previous statement, of course was a much more balanced party, including a very liberal, progressive wing, including a strong mainstream conservative group, and those have been very much weakened. So within the LDP, of course, we can see a drift to the right, which explains why these pet projects of the conservative elites are more in the focus of politics now. Yeah, thank you.
Toko Sensei, please.
Several points. First, I concur with you both that the major interest of the Japanese people is economics and their own life. Very clear. Second, overwhelming Japanese are very pacifist. Nobody wants war. Nobody even cannot think about war. Now, third, still they are happy to hear good news. Because in the last 20 years, they have been constantly news that Japan, I was also responsible in a way, in my small portion. But I came back from the abroad and I tried to tell the Japanese people that Japan is disappearing. There's no attention given in Europe and America and even Asia about the weight of Japan. It's very different from 20 years ago. What have we done? what have we done to create this situation? So the good news, for instance, that the Tokyo Olympics is coming in 2020, that Mount Fuji became World Heritage, and that economy, at least mood-wise, there's a perception, the feeling that the economy is rising. I think people like it. And they want this to continue. But then, against this contrast, current relations with China and Korea, I still have certain warning on it. As this is the third or fourth time, but China, every week, continuously entering into the territorial waters. For those who are little interested on international relations, this is accumulating a mute indignation. At this point, this is not exploding. But I think, you know, we ourselves and the Chinese in particular should pay notice to this. That something has to be done. It cannot go on like this forever. With the Koreans, what I hear repeatedly by the opinion leaders and some part of the government, that they are not happy about the moving target. Now, I think the Prime Minister's responsibility is to do something about this phenomenon and to stop it, creating a new relation, particularly at sea with China, and create a new positive cycle with the Koreans. Because in the long term, Japanese nationalists, present-day China, relations with China, present-day relations with South Korea, clearly are not sustainable. They have the need for strong political leadership. And we need such a prime minister who is capable of deploying this leadership. Because he comes from the right. If Abe wants to, I am sure he can do this. Likewise, on northern territorial issues, which we did not have a second to talk about. if Abe wants to take an audacious decision, he can do it because he comes from basically from right-wing circles. Whether he does it or not, I don't know. Thank you.
Well, I hate to break up this very interesting discussion, but as you all know, here at the Foreign Correspondents Club, we have a trick to continue these discussions. We give a one-year honorary membership to all of our three panelists, so we hope to see them at the bar, involved in very in-depth discussions with all of us. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you, the three of you, for your time. Thank you very much.